Good morning, sisters and brothers. How are we this morning? Welcome to our 11 a.m. service. That was a good old Eastern Standard Time joke. It's the only one I have. All right, this morning we will be looking into the Apostle Paul's instructions to the church at Corinth in 1 Corinthians 12. And looking in to see what implications it has for us in our context. So turn with me there in your Bibles. I'll be reading out of the ESV. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says that Jesus is accursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are a variety of services, but the same Lord. And there are a variety of activities, but it is in the same God who empowers them all to everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another a various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into the body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell? But as it is, God has arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he has chosen. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the hand say to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that are we think less honorable, we bestow the greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. It's the word of the Lord. Amen to that, yeah. So part of our involvement, my wife and I, Sarah is my wife. We have six kids. I know it's kind of strange. I get up here, you don't really know who I am. But a little bit about me. I have six kids. They range from 16. Yes, he's starting to drive. Pray for us in our community. No, he's a great kid, very wonderful kid. And we have a five-year-old going into kindergarten. So we run the gamut, and we are very involved in our community. And one way that we're involved is my wife coaches varsity sports. She's quite an athlete. I'm very proud of her. And well, one of the things that is interesting is every once in a while they won't have a great game, or maybe practice is not going well. And I'm very aware that my wife knows all kinds of things about basketball, and so I'll ask her, honey, why isn't it going well? Expecting some real intricate, like, detail. And she'll respond as somebody who knows something well with a very obvious response. They just haven't chosen to play as a team yet. They're not playing as a team. They're playing as individuals. I myself am a drummer, and I worked with a drum line in town for several years, and very often the drummers come unprepared. And when drummers don't play together, it sounds like Fritos on a drum head. And if you want to know what Fritos on a drum head sounds like, take a bag of Fritos, open it up, and dump it on a drum head. It sounds like garbledygook, so they have to decide to play as a unit. See, and this is what the Apostle Paul is bringing to bear upon a Corinthian context that is experiencing disunity. He is bringing to bear this fact that we can tend to value and praise our individual gifts and callings at the expense of others, believing that ours is principal or the thing that will bind the rest together. In fact, when we do that, it makes our view of unity quite worthless. Instead, he comes to us with one very clear imperative, and that is our main idea for this point. Our main point is this, is that we must eagerly desire unity. We must eagerly desire unity. Let's pray. Father, as we come to your word read and your word preached, let your spirit move amongst us as you promised it would, challenging us and encouraging us in the places that you know that we need, that we wouldn't leave here unchanged. Amen. So our main idea is that we must eagerly desire unity, and so since that's an imperative, let's give a couple of true things for why. You know, that two-year-old is always asking, why, or the three-year-old maybe, why? Now that's a good question, why? Why should I eagerly desire unity? Well, it's fancy enough, the passage tells us here. Number one, we are regenerated by one spirit. It is one spirit that our variety of gifts finds unity. Number two, we are baptized into one body. So let's look at that first point. We are regenerated by one spirit. See, the Apostle Paul, as he's going through 1 Corinthians, comes back to unity, back to unity, back to unity. And why is that? Well, maybe if you took a step back and thought about it with me for a second, it's because unity always needs maintaining. It always needs maintaining. In fact, if you go through the corpus of Paul's letters, every single one of his letters is about unity. Romans, unity. I mean, where do we start applying the message of Romans 1 through 11? At 12, sacrificing ourselves on the altar and not thinking more highly of oneself than they ought, but rather working as a body, right? But as Howard Hendricks says about living sacrifices, does anyone know this? They keep climbing off the altar, right? So it always needs maintaining. 1 Corinthians speaks for itself. Galatians, I'm shocked at you Galatians. Who's bewitched you that you would go to another gospel instead of the one that I preach? He's speaking about unity. Ephesians, unity. I mean, that's actually our theme passage, isn't it? And we can keep going. Paul is always looking at the unity of the body, which is going to be challenging for us American 21st century Christians to hear, us, me, my Jesus, and my quiet time Christians. We've been trained to make our faith individual, but it is absolutely not. It's immensely corporate. And so he brings to us two illustrations of unity in this passage, one spirit and a variety of gifts, and then in our second point, we're going to look at one body and many members. You see, from here, the Apostle Paul begins in 1 Corinthians to go on a trajectory of what unity looks like. In fact, at the end of this chapter, he says, eagerly desire the greater gifts, but I'll show you a more excellent way, 12:31. 14:1 then says, eagerly desire the spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. 14:39 through 40 then kind of caps it off. He kind of starts to solve the problem with the Corinthians, not really because he writes another letter, and probably three, to them. Eagerly desire to prophesy, but do everything decently and in order. Nothing? Yeah. I am talking to Presbyterians, right? There we go. Thank you. Can I just do that one more time for my heart's sake? Do everything decently and in order. I heard a come on. I went to this Baptist church once. This is not about Baptists. It's about the guy preaching. And he would get going for about an hour. And then he'd preach, pray for about 25 minutes. And it was always, preacher, preach on, preacher, preach on. I was glad to hear it from out here. That was nice. It was always him. I was like, no, wrap it up. TikTok. I have a one-year-old. He needs a nap. All right. So from here, he's going on a trajectory of unity, and how we all work together in God's design with our gifts, our callings, our roles. Yes, that thing that society has made kind of a nasty thing, roles. Are there primary roles or secondaries, first class, second class? No, roles that God has designed and talents complementing one another. So where does it all start? Well, it starts at the beginning, where the Spirit does the work. He says, remember your BC days before Christ, when you were led astray by these mute idols, however you were led, kind of, you know, it's kind of this dismissive, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking the Spirit of God ever said that Jesus was anathema, that he was not the Messiah, that he's not Lord. That is not something that comes out of the regenerate heart and mouth. The overflow of the heart comes from the mouth, right? Now, on the opposite, Jesus is Lord is the only something that somebody can say by the power of the Holy Spirit. That Jesus is Lord of my life can only come out of the mouth of those who have been regenerated. In fact, there's a man in our congregation, we'll call him Mitchell. Actually, that's his name. and this, he's a friend of mine, so he'll get it. If he's watching this, I'm sure I'll get ribbed when I get home. But Mitchell just had this fantastic conversion experience that many of us don't actually experience, but he was within the vicinity of Christians all the time. But he kept us at arm's length. And he would talk about this. And he said that there was one moment in his home when his family's at church, but he wasn't. And God said, I designed you to lead this family and you're not doing this. And his life was forever changed in that moment. The Spirit is sovereign over its regenerate activity. And faith is articulated afterwards. In fact, when he told me on a trip to Cabela's, you know, he said, do you need to go to Cabela's? I said, in fact, I do need to go to Cabela's. But when a man says they need to go to Cabela's, that's the only place where men shop. So need is more like I'd love to go hang out, yes. So we went to Cabela's and he said that. And I was shocked that the Spirit did this regenerate thing. It's that Spirit that grounds us in unity. Paul acknowledges here in this section that there is a variety of gifts, but let's not put the emphasis on the wrong syllable, okay? This passage has been so hobby-horsed for all the spiritual gifts here. That's not what this is about. That's losing the forest for the trees, my friends. No, this is not that. He says, there are all of these things, concluding statement, all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions each one individually as he wills. As he wills. This is a sovereignty thing. This is setting up for the body metaphor. The Spirit that unifies all varieties is the same Spirit that regenerates. In fact, on Monday, I'm taking my son for the second year in a row to a Doobie Brothers concert. Because they're good. And one of the concerts, though, that I was most blessed to go listen to was Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young. And those of you who actually have any really good music knowledge know that they are known for what? Their harmonies. Yeah, amazing. Even at their age, they could still do it. And what is a harmony but a collection of various notes orchestrated into that harmony, right? Those notes mean nothing apart from being together. In fact, music and the harmony of music moves us. When I was writing my sermon this morning, I was listening to... what are you laughing about? I was... Should I have not? I can't unring that bell. I'm sorry. I was listening to Chicago. You know, a little stronger every day, make me smile. You know, old days. I felt a little of that like Dwight Schrute. You know, before the sales call, a little Motley Crue. Leave the keys. You still doing that thing? Leave the keys. All right. And gets going. That's what I was. Thank you for the three of you that got that. Music moves us, and the world will see one thing and hear it and feel it, a harmony. And that's where what you guys are doing. That's what you're doing with your variety of gifts. Let's look at point two. We are baptized into one body. So actually, in 1 Corinthians, Paul comes back to baptism several times. And here again, this is not literally water baptism. However, the way in which he uses it to illustrate our inclusion into a corporate body is really what we believe and confess about the sacrament. It's the inducement into the body, okay? Again, that is, remember, what we believe about baptism, right? We're induced into the visible church and all the blessings and promises therein, right? And that's what he's saying here. You have been baptized into one body. One body. The body, just like the spirit, is one because of unity. It's one because of unity. And that unity comes about because of, track with me here, diversity. That's what university comes from. Unity in diversity. The liberal arts combine to make a whole person. Unity in diversity. In fact, let me try this out on you. Unity isn't a thing. It doesn't exist if there wasn't diversity. There would be no use for it. There would be no use for unity if there was not created diversity. In fact, if that was the case, we oftentimes confuse like-mindedness with unity. That is uniformity. That's uniformity. And so often, I'm going to direct this to my audience here, because there's a lot of criticisms that could be heaped up, or critiques, maybe let's not use criticisms, a lot of critiques. But within the church, we oftentimes value uniformity. And when diversity comes up, we're like, you sure you really want to do that? You might ruffle some feathers. You might rock the boat. But we as a denomination have such a value in our motto. We have the bedrock, the one spirit and the one body of our essentials, our constitution, our confession, our catechisms, where everything is rooted so that we can be sure we are unified. We're also diverse, and in that diversity, we have liberty. What a valuable gift. And in all those things, we have charity, but let's be careful that we don't so idolize charity that we stifle diversity. You can stifle diversity because we so idolize the fake peace. Let voices talk. Let us contribute. Listen. Dialogue. It's hard work, give and take. Unity assumes diversity. In this, we have a variety of members. Look at verse 13 with me. It says, for in one spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. Friends, I think this has a very valuable statement to the world watching and to us here. Arrows pointed in, looking out as well, that Paul is saying, when you are baptized into this body, you leave the world's dividing lines behind and you embrace God's design for the diversity that brings about the unity. You leave those dividing lines behind. That's the fact of the matter there. There is diversity, but not as the world is catechizing you to see it. In fact, Paul takes great pains to explain the absurdness of uniformity instead of unity. He actually takes on this what we could call a personification metaphor. Suddenly, like the ear and the nose and the eye, they're like humans, kind of. He makes them into persons. And look with me here. It says, for the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body. And he goes and he rolls that out. I'm not going to reread it to you, but you get that. There's a but, though. And I always love the word but in the Apostle Paul, because it means he's going to contrast it with something that is just life-altering. He says, but as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one as he chose. moving on, you might think that verse 21, if you're still looking at your Bibles, look there, you might think that Paul's being repetitious in this next paragraph. He's not, actually. You see, verses 14 through 18 is about a personal insecurity that I have nothing to add. I am not an I, therefore I cannot add what they have. This next section is you saying, they don't have what I don't have, therefore they're not worth it, or they should not be listened to. The first one is an arrow at you, assuring you that God put you in that place for a reason, and the other one's an arrow to the other people saying, hey, look, there's going to be parts that you might think are weak. There might be parts you think are unpresentable, but what you do is you give them dignity. You give them belief. Why do we do this? Another but. 24b, look there, second half of 24. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. That's so valuable. We're being catechized every day by the world for division. We can divide it by everything. But he's saying, look, this is a new way. This is the right way. So last Saturday, my wife and I celebrated our 17th anniversary. She claims 20. I mean, I'm serious. And it's true. I'll claim it too. And as, you know, we go through our wedding vows, right? Many of you have done this. You come to this point where the two shall become one flesh, right? The two shall become one flesh. And in fact, not to get too nerdy on you, but I think that there's a great illustration in the Targums, an early translation. It says, and the man will leave the bed of his father and mother and join the bed of his wife. That's how it actually says it. This is what happens here. We become one flesh. We are no longer 50-50. We're no longer your bank account and my bank account. We're no longer, where do you want to go to dinner? I chose last time, you need to choose this time. Oh, you don't have that discussion? Okay. No, you're one flesh. You're for one another. Interesting thing about my wife and I, and for many, some of you that know us, we couldn't be more diverse. I'm 6'3", she's 5'3". She's a severe introvert. I can't stop talking to people. It's a real problem. No, I mean, external processor, internal processor, right? Great at details, and I forget things all the time. We're very diverse, but we are one flesh. Friends, this is exactly what this passage is about. You aren't your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God with your body. You are part of a body. You are not your own. When one part of the body suffers, the whole body suffers actually. And the whole body rejoices, the whole body, or the one part of the body rejoices, the whole body rejoices. Actually. And that's actually an international fact, too. If we are putting God first, if we are worshiping Him, that affects our believing sisters and brothers in China. It affects our believing brothers and sisters in Southeast Asia, in Africa, and so on. Because the chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. We are one flesh with each believer. That is what will continue to maintain unity among a diverse crowd. Let's pray. Father, you are so good. You have blessed us with diversity, and because of that, have called us into a unified harmony. That a melody might go out, even from this mouth that can't sing, to a world that is watching, that is eager for hope. So, with that same eagerness, let's, as a body, be eager for unity. only by the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen.